Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.
Good evening. Welcome to Pro Life Berks. I'm Kathy Kuhns. I'm your host this evening. I'm also producer for this program. And we're coming around to another anniversary. Next month, we will be on this program for 21 years. So we thank God for that. And thank you all for watching and tuning in. And we thank BCTV for all the years that they've been so good to us and getting us on the air. This evening, we have a live guest. We're in the studio. And the topic of our discussion is going to be the wonders of fetal development. This sounds kind of technical, but we have an extremely knowledgeable guest who can put things in layman's terms so he can really make it so that all of us can understand what he's talking about. But he's just a wonderful person. I've known Peter for 20 years too, I think, or maybe more. And he's one of the smartest people I know. He's an author. He's a speaker. He's just an extremely knowledgeable person, prolific writer. You're going to enjoy him. I am not going to be able to get much in here because Peter has so much to say. I told him he could probably talk for 4 days. He knows so much on the subject. But he said he'd keep it down to an hour. So we welcome that. And we also welcome your questions and comments. Since we're live, you can call in to Peter. The number here is 610-378-0426. Peter would love to answer your questions, no matter how simple or how complex. I'm sure he'll be able to handle it. With that introduction, I'd like to present Dr. Peter Floriani. Welcome, Peter.
Thank you, Kathy.
And we would like you to tell our viewers a little bit about your background, how you got your PhD and so forth.
Well, it's it was an interesting experience academically. I went through my bachelor's in what was called then fundamental science, which means I have a little tiny bit of every kind of science. Because at that point in time, which was maybe in the early Stone Age, they didn't have a computer science degree. Later, I went back for my master's, and that's in computer science. And then a little bit later than that, a friend of mine, who was then at the National Institute of Health, was doing his postdoctoral work there, called me because they didn't have the software to do the cancer research he was trying to get
at
done.
NIH.
At the NIH.
Wow.
And I wrote it for him.
Wow.
Before breakfast that day.
Oh my gosh.
And he laughed his head off about this, and he loves telling the story. But it was very simple. Speaking as a software person, it was very simple. That was before I went back for my doctorate, too. So you don't say, oh it's because you were a doctorate. It's like, no. And I said, you know, I really should think about this seriously. And I said, especially if you're going to have more work in this sort of thing. So I went back for my doctorate in computer science, and that's what I got my degree in.
Uh-huh.
And while I was there, and just because this is always fun to tell, because people do always bring this sort of thing up, one of my committee members, which you have to have a committee when you go for your doctorate of professors,
they're
the special examiners who ask all the questions and make all the fusses. She was, as she termed it herself, the chairman of the biology department. One of the most brilliant women I've ever known.
Uh-huh.
One of the most brilliant faculty at that school, which I won't say. She was worldwide known for her work on certain very specific complex issues having to do with how rice grows, which is, of course, as you know, an incredibly important foodstuff for a very large part of the world.
Mm-hmm.
They were doing, and I don't have to get technical because it's very easy to say, they needed to accomplish what I like to call fingerprints for bacteria.
Oh.
And it was done through DNA sequence analysis.
Uh-huh.
The problem is it was one of these riddles that computer people hardly ever get challenged with. Because normally when you go searching, you know what you're looking for and you try to find it.
Uh-huh.
This time, we don't know what we're looking for, but we still need to define it.
Wow.
And it's a backwards problem, which I don't need to go into because it doesn't apply here.
Right.
But that was what I did my work on.
Wow.
And so I can, as I like to tell people, I know how to spell DNA. And people always laugh and go, ha ha. But that's what I did. That's how I do this.
That's
and
interesting. Because you always have such good stories.
It was, well, it's good. It is a good story, but it was real.
Goodness.
And it was, their work was funded by the Department of Energy, believe it or not, because they were trying to study how pollution affects the environment relative to how many bacteria of different kinds you could find in a given sample. And they were using this technique. And I aided them by finding the patterns in the DNA that they needed to do their work. Because they could do their work in the biology, but they didn't know how to do the finding, this weird backwards finding problem.
Yeah. Wow.
So that's how I fit into the bio picture.
Wow. That's really interesting.
Now you know.
What a background. So how did you get interested in fetal development of all things?
Because
I know you're expert on many things.
Well,
this in particular.
I read many things, but here's how that works, okay? First of all, as part of anybody's training in computing, when you're very serious about this sort of thing, you learn how they put together. You learn how they work. You learn all the different aspects of all the internal things that go on inside the computer. Now, most people have no clue, and I'm not going to talk about the computing part, but let me tell you just a tiny bit about what it's like when you talk about this other word that was really important called medicine, physicians, nurses, and fetal development.
Mm-hmm.
You have to study, well, you say, well, we study biology, but what do you study? You study, first of all, what's called anatomy. That's the overall structure of the body, the bones, the blood vessels, the muscles, the nerves, the digestive organs, the organs of sense. It's, and on it goes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's at one level. That's the topmost level. Then we go down a level to what's called histology. That's the study of tissues. That's what makes the organ. Mm-hmm. Now, if it's a pipe organ, it's different. That's music. But this is biology organs. And there you need tissues. And how are the different parts of a bone put together? And then you learn strange things about the bone because you don't think, we all think of them because we see skeletons at Halloween and stuff, but we don't realize there's a very intricate structure to a bone.
Mm-hmm.
I could have talked about that in relation to the fetal development because it's fascinating because for the most part, most of the fetal life, there aren't bones.
Mm-hmm.
There's something else. It's called cartilage. But you go down a level from histology. That's called cytology. The study of cells, because the cells are the parts that make up the tissues are the parts that make up the organs are the part that make up the body. And it goes down another level, one more, to molecular biology. How is the machine of the cell doing its work? Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, we are now at a frontier. And unlike some of the frontiers of human geography, this is a very happy frontier. The frontier is the frontier with chemistry, another absolutely vast discipline, as vast as biology. But it's a happy frontier because on the other side is what's called organic chemistry. And at the junction, some of us call it molecular biology and some of us call it biochemistry.
Mm-hmm.
But it's really the same subject.
Mm-hmm.
It's what chemicals are in the cells, what chemicals are needed by the cells, what chemicals are used by the cells.
Hmm.
So you need to know organic if you're going to try to do that sort of thing too.
Mm-hmm.
But we're not going to go too deep. We only have one or two words of that discipline to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
But mostly, and I gave you the picture, that's all the basics that a physician and a nurse has to have.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have to learn what can go wrong. And that's what makes up most of medicine in these current days, and especially when we're faced with so many challenges right now, not just the present virus.
Mm-hmm.
So, having said all this about the hugeness of this topic, and I started looking at it, I said, my gosh, of course, the most important thing is blood. And I said, hemoglobin. Well, there's the word, see, hemoglobin. We'll talk about it a little bit later. I started getting all my books out, and I said, brought 7 different volumes out to look at, say, what things do I have to say, and what things do I have to look up? I said, oh, well, this is going to be hard to take, because you think about the wonders. There's so many wonders, because you don't hardly know where to start, because every single thing is a wonder.
That's
so,
what I think.
So what
but
what
happened? Are the most wonderful of the wonders?
Well, here's the fun
if there are and this more is the wonderful first, than others.
Since we're starting, the question is, and we're not going to start in quite the same way, because we're not going to go into the technical details of what happens at the very earliest stages. I want to give you a different thought.
Okay.
Almost every one of us has a computer or has used the computer.
Right.
And you know that what you do when it's turned off at the beginning, you turn it on. And you do what has this strange word that most people don't understand called boot the computer. Now, I could tell you
that
why
I know.
It's called that, but we're not. It's not. That's tech in the computing side. We don't need it. Now, everybody thinks, there's this stuff called apps. We call them programs or user programs, user applications. And there's this thing called the operating system, and it's either Unix or Windows or something else if you might possibly have something very unusual in your computer, or you write your own. But when it starts, it's not anything. It's just the electronics. It's not running any program. It has to immediately start running something. And that sequence that occurs, which happens once and only once while the computer's powered up, is a specialized routine called the bootstrap program. And when I remember seeing how this was done on the computer at this school. And it was this huge panel of about, 200 switches. And the switches were all set up and down, depending on the instructions that they represented. Mm-hmm. And this panel said, in order to start the computer, you obey these instructions in this sequence.
Wow.
And exactly, and then when you did it, when you pushed the button, and it was one little button that you had to push to make the computer start, it obeyed those instructions, and then it went to the magnetic tapes and starting pulling in the information to build the system.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's sort of what happens at the moment of fertilization. There's a series of instructions that have to start getting executed, and the cells start dividing. That's all more I can say about that, because it gets way too detailed.
Yeah, that's a whole subject.
Difficult.
For,
but here's
for
the first
program,
thing, and this
but...
is the first wonder. There's 3 things that have to be arranged almost immediately after it gets past the very tiniest stage. Mm-hmm. And that is what you could call the 3 axes of the body. And if you have anything to do with aircraft or flying, and you know about the pitch and the yaw and the roll, and you know that there's 3 axes, you can spin on your head. Mm-hmm. It's the 3 shapes that you can make with your head to indicate things. You have the no axis, you have the yes axis, and you have the I don't know axis.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the 3. And that's the first thing it has to do. It has to chemically say, I declare this is the top of my body.
Oh, my goodness.
And this is the bottom of my body.
Wow.
And it knows based on where it has
gone. Where the head's going to go, where the feet are going.
It knows exactly. And once it's decided, it never, ever changes. And it's done by a chemical. And you say, how is this done? I'm not going to try to explain that, but I can tell you how you can actually do it, because it's described in the right sort of biology books.
Uh-huh.
It's classic experiment. It was done several hundred years ago by a man named Fabricius, and he drew pictures, gorgeous pictures. You get a bunch of eggs, fertilized eggs from a farm, and each day you crack one open. You keep them warm.
Mm-hmm.
Each day you crack them one open, and you do your study with your microscope, and you'll see this happening in those eggs until 21 days later, the last egg that you have, make sure you have enough, the last egg will be the chick. But it knows, and they all have to do this. And even the most simple
And this is all done by chemicals.
It's all done by the assertion of certain very special chemicals. The word that's used is hormone. What is a hormone? This is a descriptive word from organic chemistry, biochemistry.
Mm-hmm.
It's a control chemical.
Mm-hmm.
It's different from an enzyme because an enzyme works in the cell.
Mm-hmm.
A hormone works among cells.
Okay.
So a hormone is like, you could say, well, it's sort of like cell phones, but that's not right. It's sort of like radio. Well, it's not quite right either,
mm-hmm.
but it can control distant cells.
Hmm.
The most famous one of all, and it's not one of those sex ones or anything like that, the most famous one of all, and everybody knows this word, it's called adrenaline.
Mm-hmm.
When you get excited,
right,
there's a whole certain thing that happens. And when you find out how that works, the brain sends a signal down to a tiny little gland that sits on top of the back of your kidneys back mm-hmm. here, and they turn on a crank that starts chemical flowing. And those glands happen to sit right on the main blood vessel that runs back up to your heart. So the very second that chemical gets in the blood, it gets sent out to the whole body, and your whole body
right.
turns on alert. That's a hormone.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That's how this works. Maybe these three, they're construction hormones, not alert hormones,
mm-hmm.
or not these other things. They're specific, and they say, from now on, this is top, this is bottom. This is mm-hmm. right, this is left, this mm-hmm. is front, this is back. And all the rest has to obey those chemical constraints so that everything happens in the right order.
Hmm.
That's the first
wow,
one.
That's
up and down,
that's
right
really
and left.
Interesting. I never thought of it. Up. I mean, who thinks that deeply?
No, but they
you just
had
think
to
of
study.
The cells dividing, but you don't think
that's,
of how that
how you
happens.
Had to
you know,
study.
What starts that? That's fascinating.
That's
really
it's
is.
Very interesting. And it's also because it gets into geometry. It gets into chemistry.
Mm-hmm.
It even, as I said, it even smacks of aircraft and flying and stuff like that. There's a lot of thought that has to go into these sorts of things.
Wow.
And as I said, remember, this is accessible because it's through, you can study this even in a chicken, which is very, so it takes 21 days to hatch mm-hmm. an egg. Okay, next topic. And this one was the one I was a little bit hesitant to use the word. But I thought, no, it's all right. It's not that bad of a word. And it's mm-hmm. also a completely normal word. This mm-hmm. happens to everybody during development. And it's a very mm-hmm. strange sounding thing. But to introduce it properly, I'm going to appeal to another great scientist. His name, you might have heard of him, Albert Einstein.
Yes, I think we've all heard of him.
He invented... another kind of experiment that didn't use eggs. He invented what's called the Gedanken experiment. That means the thought experiment. Remember, he was German, or Austrian, excuse me.
Mm-hmm.
Thought experiment. So we're going to think about this, okay? I'm going to give you a deck of cards. And you have to put... They're scrambled. That's because I have eggs on the brain. They're scrambled. I mean, they're shuffled.
Shuffled.
They're shuffled, and I want you to put them in order, okay? But you can't put them down, so you're going to cram them in your hand, and
mm-hmm.
you're going to have a real tough time
right.
putting them in order because you're holding them in your hand.
Mm-hmm.
Then I do it again and say, that's too bad. Don't work so hard. Here's this nice big empty table. Put them out on the table and sort them on the table, and you go boop, 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 and you put them out, and it'll be very easy because you can put them by suit, and you can put them by number, and it's really, really simple, right? Because you have workspace.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in computers, that's really important. We have to always worry about that. That's why people always say, make sure you buy a big disk drive. Make sure you have lots of memory.
Mm-hmm.
You need workspace. That's what those are for. So, here's this baby getting put together. There's this part. We'll just use the word digestive organs. And they're growing. And they can't just grow into the pattern that they end up being when we're adults or even when they're born.
Mm-hmm.
They have to grow. It grows and extends and grows and grows. And all of a sudden it's like I can't be doing this in my hand.
Mm. Oh.
But the body's only this big. And remember, there's actually another membrane around all this that keeps mm-hmm. everything correctly arranged mm-hmm. for various other chemical and biological reasons. Where do you get the workspace? Where does it put the extra length that needs to be arranged? Like on this table, it has to have room to put them together mm-hmm. so that they can be put in back correctly in order.
Mm-hmm.
It uses this strange part of your body called the umbilical cord.
Mm-hmm.
And you say, wait a second, you mean it basically pushes part of your internal organs out into that umbilical cord during the development? And the answer is yes. It's called the physiological hernia. Now remember, there's
what is it again?
The physiological hernia. Huh. It's a standard, normal, well-known part of fetal development. But it all has to do with having sufficient extra workspace to get it arranged properly. That's what it's for. And there's plenty of room in it because mm-hmm. it can expand. And these things are very small, so it's not like it really is there's any risk or bulging or something like
right.
that. It's just something unusual. Because the odd thing that you have to remember is the umbilical cord is part of the baby too.
Right.
And that brings us to the next wonder. That wonder is what I call the organ we all lose. And it's not the umbilical cord, it's what the umbilical cord connects to. The placenta.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, that's baby's organ. It's not the mother's organ, it's the baby's organ. The baby constructs it. The mother, without going into this is the barrier of the detail that I'm going mm-hmm. to go into. I'm not going into that part. Certain parts having to do with arrangement of the maternal side of the question mm-hmm. are all made ready for that possibility. We don't need to say any more.
Well, does the placenta develop at the same time or before?
It's all at the exact same moment. Okay. All the rest of it. Remember when I said at the very beginning, it starts immediately dividing mm-hmm. and then there's up, down, right, left?
Mm-hmm.
The down is basically to the mother.
Okay.
But there's an initial down. It moves around later because things are going to be now loose. It's now loose because the umbilical cord allows it like the astronaut in space to float outside.
Right.
That's why they call it the umbilical cord. But it's the initial development has to do with it points at the mother.
Mm.
It points to the mother and says, you're mine. And it begins this connection. And the placenta is so intricate. You think the eye is intricate, the nose, the brain. The brain is intricate. But why is the placenta unusually different? It's because it's several organs at once.
Really?
It's the lung, because it's
really?
The oxygen. It also takes away the carbon dioxide. It's the kidney. It takes out the useless liquids that aren't needed anymore.
Uh-huh.
It's the intestine, because not only does it bring food in from the mother, it brings the waste matter out from the baby.
Hmm.
And it's almost like, and this is a bad word, but I'm going to say it anyway, it's like the skin. It's a barrier.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw several books, I checked it in several books. Most particulate matter, most large invaders, that means bacteria,
mm-hmm.
cannot cross.
Mm.
Viruses, unfortunately, can cross. And mm-hmm. as far back as 1965, it says smallpox, for example.
Okay.
So it does. Viruses can get across. Mm-hmm. And there are certain proteins, certain other things. Most of the proteins, it turns out, get disassembled. That's part of the machinery that we normally use in our bodies. We disassemble mm-hmm. proteins. So when we eat meat or milk or eggs or even certain vegetable materials,
mm-hmm.
we tear apart the proteins and reduce them to what's called amino acids. Those are just the chemical parts. Mm-hmm. And we put them back together to make the parts of us. Mm-hmm. That's how this is done.
I want you to stop there for a minute. I want to remind our viewers, take a look at these pictures. And it may, besides what Peter's talking about, if you look at these a little bit, maybe you have some question that you'd like to ask Peter about the whole development of the baby. And as I said before, you could call in. We're live. The number here is 610-378-0426. We'd love to hear from you. And Peter can answer anything, I guarantee.
If not, I'll get back to you. Yeah, obviously, be honest.
I think there's very few questions that you couldn't answer. So.
No.
Okay. So you were talking about the placenta, which I think is totally fascinating because you only ever think of it as being there for nourishment.
It does a lot. It has...
But that's such a vital part of the development.
It's impossible to go on. Here's why, and we're going to get to this in just a minute. But let me just show you one of the few numbers that I have. The effective area of transport, that is this barrier which is up against the bacteria is allowing for oxygen and everything, all the good stuff to happen, is 140 square feet. Now, a room, 10 by 14 foot room. That's how big an area of the floor it is. That's how huge
the surface
area within the placenta, that's how big it is.
Wow.
It's 50 times as big as the skin of the newborn.
Oh, my goodness.
And the volume of blood from the mother that's coursing through it is basically about half a quart, 600 milliliters. I think that's roughly right. Right, somewhere over half a quart. Two pints of blood have to be flowed. And this is where the fascinating way in which this transportation has to occur, because I told you this the other day when we talked about this. You can go drive down the road and you will see mounted up on the big telephone poles and everything, power lines.
Oh, yeah.
You'll see these funny boxes.
The transformers.
They're the transformers. Yeah. This is basically what's going on there, because the maternal circulation is entirely separate from the baby circulation. They're kept separate.
By the placenta.
The placenta sets up.
Well, now I have a question for you. I've read this several times that some of the cells from the baby do get into the mother's bloodstream and they've actually found fetal tissue, you know, like in a woman's brain or liver. Is that true?
There is a discussion. It says under normal conditions, the barrier is impervious and it is kept totally separate. Mm-hmm. The only things that can get across are very simple chemicals and certain proteins, and certain other things are what's called lipids, which is we would call fats when you talk about cooking. Mm-hmm. Okay, that means butter, margarine, stuff like that, cheese. Those are fat, you know, nuts. Things that have fats in them, those are called chemically called lipids, I think is the right way of saying it. I always send it, for some reason, the brain plays that game on me. Mm-hmm. Those go across. But depending on what's called mechanical stresses within the baby kicks it.
Oh.
For example, it could hurt the placenta.
Oh.
And a little bit. Remember, this is a very, very complex and delicate organ, and if it's broken, part of what is really the baby's tissues can get into the maternal circulation.
Oh, that's how it happens.
And then it will send it across.
That's
because remember, a cell is very small.
Right.
While the blood vessels at that level, you see. Because the way it's built, normally the blood that goes, this is where you have to know these other layers. Remember I told you the histology, the anatomy, histology, cytology, molecular biology. This is where the histology normally comes in, because you see, for the most of all parts of our body are supplied by capillaries. They're mm-hmm. the tiniest blood vessels. Mm-hmm. They are not arteries. They're not veins. What they are, the transport mechanism for the rest, for our body, for the adult body. Mm-hmm. They give the oxygen, bring oxygen, take carbon dioxide away, and bring the nutrients. Take away waste. Mm-hmm. That's not what's happening in the placenta from the mother's side. The mother's side of transportation, the transport level, the easiest way of saying it is it's like it's little tiny fountains. They're little tiny arterial fountains. And they fire on and off, on and off, on mm-hmm. and off, on and off throughout the different parts of the placenta, spurting out the good, the blood arterial. That means the good, the kind that has the oxygen in it, okay? Mm-hmm. It's red, okay? It flows over the capillaries that are immersed within this fountain spray. Mm-hmm. And so the baby's blood is transported across that barrier. That's where the that's the real barrier.
Okay.
Is between this fountain part and the capillaries of the baby.
Uh-huh.
Okay? So, now the maternal blood has gone across those capillaries, and they go, this is good, I'm taking it. Oh, I don't want that. Don't give it to me. So it takes brings stuff in and doesn't take certain other things across that line. Mm-hmm. And there are control things. This is very, very deep, lowest level stuff in molecular biology, mm-hmm. that how that control can be done. But mm-hmm. There are chemical ways of making that happen. And they're basically like crossing guards, mm-hmm. barriers, and traffic cops, and guys at the gate that allow people to come in or don't allow people to come in. So the blood flows across this and then flows back out. But it's not, there's like little chambers where the fountains occur. Mm-hmm. But there's no other capillary. It's actually structured very, very specially. Mm-hmm. And there is the brilliant stuff that's arranged from an engine. Since I'm a half engineer, I have to worry about this. There's this whole thing that has to happen. You say, boy, isn't that a strange liability for once you get born? And it's mm-hmm. like, yes. And it actually, again, it's actually written about. It says, yes. Why doesn't the mother suddenly die of blood loss? Because the uterus contracts so strongly that everything seals up almost immediately.
Really?
At the very end. Yes, it's brilliant engineering. And that brings us to circulation. That's the next one.
Okay.
Where are we here? Oh, funny part.
Hope you're all keeping up with this.
I hope I'm not going overwhelming.
No, I'm following you. I can't say that I understand and everything, but I'm understanding saying.
But at least I didn't use too many big words. I hope. If I did, well, you can call in and ask. So, let me see the blood. Why is this blood thing so important? You say, well, it's because of oxygen. But there's actually a much more important question. What is the very first part of the baby to get finished? And that is the circulation.
Mm-hmm. The heart beats.
The heart has to be made finished. The heart, there are actually the three parts. The heart, the rest of the blood vessels, and the blood cells. They all have to come
basically. And the heartbeat's at 18 to 21 days after conception.
Chicken, but it's like even sooner than in the chickens faster. But what is the real reason? And it's a design reason. Mm-hmm. It's because, and this is the fun fact that it took me a while to find, and I had read it and I couldn't find it for a while, and because I lost what page, I forgot to write it down. No tissue can be thicker than 1 millimeter. And you can't even show you how big that
goodness.
Is. It's a 25th of an inch. So if imagine cutting an inch into 25 little strips. It can't be any thicker than that from a source of oxygen. It has to be that close or it doesn't get any air. So anything to get any bigger than 1 millimeter, mm-hmm. and this is true throughout all living things, it's not just for humans. Mm-hmm. This is everything. Hmm. All things that use oxygen. There's a tiny handful, but they're only bacteria that do this, so they don't count. And plants work the other way most during the daylight hours. But all things have to have oxygen to keep the cells alive. And the only way for things to get thicker or bigger than 1 millimeter is to have a blood supply, an arrangement. So the very first thing, the first real directed organ system that is going to be put together and come up and running is the circulatory system. That's all extremely simple when it starts. And at the end, and again, this is where you need to know the anatomy, which I don't need to try to talk about now. You can probably see it in one of these pictures. But you have...
And what makes the... Is it a chemical that makes the heart take its first beat?
It has to be... Well, it has to be big enough. It has to be big enough. It has to come... And it's very... The funny thing is what it looks like. And unfortunately, I don't have a picture unless it's on here, which I doubt. But you have to imagine this tube, okay? This is all this is. The initial heart is a tube built of cells, okay? Remember, this is an open cylinder. It's a tube. And there are two valves. A valve is like a flap. And it opens and closes so that things can go through. But when it closes this way, the stuff can only go one direction. It's a one-way street for blood. Okay, it can't go backwards. What happens is this one closes, and this, which is made of muscle, contracts. It gets smaller. Well, this one is pushed open by the fact that this volume has now shrunk. So the blood is pushed out through the valve, and it goes out. And this one cannot go backwards because the valve is closed. So the pushing can't go backwards. So there's blood building up on that side. And now, so then what happens is this one closes, this one opens, and this fills back up with blood, and then it squashes itself again. But remember, it has to, there's no brain at this point. It's only the very beginnings of what's called the notochord. It's the preliminary machinery of the nervous system. There isn't a brain as such.
Oh, right. Yeah, you need the nervous system.
There's only certain parts that become the brain. But the heart is built. And the thing is, look, there's only two valves. How many valves are in the normal of the heart? It's much more complex. And there's four chambers, not just one. And that's where the fun comes in. And this is the third, fourth wonder. Where's the page here? I'm going to read this one apart to you because it's just fascinating. This is from this excellent, excellent 700-page book from 1965, incredibly detailed developmental anatomy book by Dr. Airy. He says, as a mammalian embryo advances through the stages, cleavage, marilla, blastocyst, and germ layers, it satisfies all its metabolic needs by simple diffusive interchanges. What does that mean? That means if you ever dip your napkin in a cup of coffee and see the coffee steep up into it, that's diffusion. You can grow when you're tiny by having the chemicals, the needed things, the nutrients come in, the oxygen come in, the carbon dioxide in the waste could go out all the way. Coffee goes up through in and out through a napkin or through a coffee maker filter. That's all it is. That's diffusion. But as the embryo continues to gain size and begins to take form, a functioning circulatory system becomes necessary in order to make use of required food and oxygen obtainable from the mother's blood. That's the placenta. Hence, he says, and this is a gorgeous sense, the heart and blood vessels are the first organ system to reach the functional state. That's why this is so cool. And you think about how it happens. It has to be put together really fast because you can't grow any bigger until it's all up and running. Now, where's the one other thing that's fun about?
That's amazing.
Isn't it cool? It's cool as heck. There's even more. Because remember, that's the simple tube. Two valves. The heart is really complicated. And you look at it and you go, where's all that other stuff coming from? But think about this. All you have to do, and you say, I don't understand any of the biology. I say, that's all right. Think about any time you've ever gone through a construction zone on the roads or a highway. And imagine the idea of how hard it would be to build an interchange or put in a new highway or a new bridge or something like that, and never, ever stop letting traffic go through it.
Oh, wow.
Once the heart starts to beat, it, everything that happens to it has to preserve its beat. It has to keep working. It can't stop. You can't do the trick with the physiological hernia and say, well, let's shut it off while we build something different. You can't. It's a lot. The heart has to beat to keep alive. So that means every last change that happens has to keep the functionality correct. And that is the very, very deep type of real development.
That seems almost impossible.
It does seem you almost know? Impossible. And that's why it's a wonder.
Yeah.
But the professionals, the physicians that deal with fetal development, they can go through this in incredible detail. And there's some very fascinating things. And one of the most fascinating, because, for example, a dear friend of mine told me about her father, who she remembered as a little girl, could never lift her. He could never hold her.
Oh.
He could never do any certain things. He had to always take it easy when he went for walks. Uh-huh. And there are many other things. And she said it wasn't until she went to become a nurse and learn about what's called, I think it's the tetralogy of Fallot.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
This is a very serious sequence of problems where the heart wasn't quite finished building. There are two parts, and we don't have the time and don't have the arrangements of diagramming to show you. But one is called the foramen ovale, which is the opening between the two sides.
Right.
And another part.
That's fairly common, not real common, but
it happens. And then there's another one called the ductus arteriosus, which basically it's like this thing with the highways. It's a bypass. It's used during life in the womb. And almost immediately, within hours, I think it said, after birth, as soon as the lungs fill with oxygen, the pressures change. The two different pressures change in the two sides of the heart. And the pressure on the left side suddenly builds up and pushes slams the foramen ovale closed. And it's because it was a valve, and now it's closed. And it says, from now on, you'll never open again. And in correct, normal people, it does sometimes happen not.
That's just
Isn't
amazing.
It fantastic? And just there's other amazing. Things, and you say, how is this all designed? Because a baby doesn't breathe.
Right.
I mean, sorry, excuse me. I should say, well, the pre-birth baby doesn't breathe.
Right.
The baby does breathe when he gets out.
Right.
But that's where the change occurs, because the oxygen hitherto was being supplied through the mother and the placenta.
Then within the 18 days, the heart is totally formed.
No, only the initial form, only the simplest one.
Okay.
A pump, simple one, two-valve pump.
Okay.
Everything
I see.
That changes after that. There's all kinds
then
of other things.
What's
that
the time sequence between that and the fully developed heart? Would you guess?
A similar, I think it's something like 2 months. I thought it was, it's not, oh wait, let me see. I might have it here. I have a cheat sheet here. No, it doesn't say.
Okay.
I thought I
just
had
curious,
it on here, but no,
curious.
It doesn't. I wanted to say it was that, but I have I only have a handful of the of some of the other parts
because
of the
body. Because it seems so incredible
to
even get a heartbeat in 18 days.
Yeah.
I mean, that's
it's because the
just
the,
over 2 weeks.
Detected.
I mean, how can
that
possibly develop that fast?
Because these things are growing quite rapidly. Here's one of the facts that I learned about at the chemical level. That's so incredible. And this is the computing.
Mm-hmm.
And this is where you say, well, how can you keep all this organized? It's like, that's the point of being somebody that's enthusiastic about science.
Right.
And crosses all the boundaries. Because then you can get really excited and see.
That's what you're good at.
Human DNA has 100 copies of the code for what's called the ribosome. the ribosome is the machine of this cell. We all have this. This is normal, totally normal stuff. In fact, most living creatures have, I think probably all living creatures have ribosomes because that's how you make proteins. Mm-hmm. We have 100 copies. And this is where the very sophisticated, very, very difficult computer science stuff called parallel processing, where you have multiple things happening all at once. Mm-hmm. It is possible for your cells to run all 100 copies at once within the living cell. All 100 copies are all themselves running, and they're spewing out every sequence of processes. 100 new forms of ribosome come out to go and build things, and they go out and build more proteins. And you have to have this incredibly dynamic processing power.
Yeah, and every system knows what to do.
And they all do because they're all directed by the chemicals that are being transformed by the ribosome from the DNA. Now, here's the last thing, because we only have about 2 minutes, and I can summarize this very quickly, because there's one thing I do want to say, and that is, because we got to the blood, mm-hmm. is about the hemoglobin, which is how I where I thought I was going to start. And I can't say too much, but I will say this, because this is incredibly important. The arrangement is normally done in your body mm-hmm. to send oxygen out of your lungs into the blood, and then from the blood out to your body, mm-hmm. and then to bring the carbon dioxide back. And it's done by the fact that there's a balance between the lungs have more oxygen and the blood has less. So the oxygen goes to that side and goes mm-hmm. out into the blood. And then when the opposite happens, when it's outside of the body, it says, I'll get down to my toes, and the toes don't have as much oxygen, so the oxygen leaves the blood and goes to the toes. Mm-hmm. How does it get to the baby? Mm. And the answer, the short answer, because we only have a minute.
Oh, we have 10 minutes.
10 minutes?
Yeah.
The fetal hemoglobin is not the same as adult hemoglobin.
Oh.
It cheats. It's built different. Oh. Hemoglobin is this incredibly complex, beautifully chemically complex cage. Two alpha sequences, two beta sequences, uh-huh. holding this strange little mounting bracket called the pyrrole ring. Made uh-huh. of heme, and in the middle is an iron, and the iron holds the oxygen, and that's how it carries.
So this is prenatally.
No, this is human. This is us.
Yeah, but the blood free birth.
Yes,
the hemoglobin is different. Then once it starts breathing air,
it switches to the other form. But it doesn't matter because it will still do the work. But right. It works different. Okay. It basically tricks the, in a certain sense, you could say it tricks the mother. But what it's not the mother. It's the chemical balance between the oxygens in the two sides. Uh-huh. It's more efficient at moving the oxygen. So the oxygen goes towards that way and grabs. It's not good. Because remember, it's not going to cells. It's going to a different circulation. Uh-huh. So it has to be more efficient. That blood has to be more efficient. It has two gamma structures mm-hmm. instead of two beta structures. And it's more efficient at holding the oxygen. It actually is richer blood. The baby's blood is richer, and mm-hmm. here's where this is fascinating, and this is what is the stunning, strange thing to have learned, and it may concern certain people more than others, but there's this thing called sickle cell anemia.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I study that too, because the DNA is important, because it's mm-hmm. very interesting. There's one letter difference, one letter coded difference in those that have sickle cell that makes the beta part of the hemoglobin different from normal beta hemoglobin. But notice, remember I said fetal hemoglobin mm-hmm. doesn't have beta chains. It only has mm-hmm. gamma chains. That means there's a way of circumventing sickle cell by getting the body to regenerate the fetal hemoglobins.
Oh.
And there is. There's a chemical, and I didn't write it down, and I forgot what it is, but there's a medical way.
Really?
Of helping serious sickle cell
right.
by stimulating the rebuilding of fetal hemoglobin in the adults. So it's remedy, and here you have. Now, there you see the junction of a whole bunch of sciences
right.
at once.
Oh, my gosh.
The chemical, the biochemical, the fetal, the medical treatments, the chemistry of getting the medications, the right. arrangements of this organizational fashion. And you say, look, here's another place where knowing a little more can help people right. in very serious conditions. And it right. is a serious condition.
That is, yes. Yes.
But that's the answer, and it's the, apparently it can happen under natural conditions.
Yeah.
It will the body can basically trick itself into starting running the fetal sequence to build fetal hemoglobin yeah. again. But there's a chemical way of getting it to mm-hmm. basically getting it to trick it out. So that's the basic thing.
Well,
those are five,
amazing.
Five
I mean, and that doesn't even you haven't talked about the digestive system.
No.
And all the feet of intestine that has to develop.
Well, that was the business I didn't want to say.
Yeah, but that would be, I mean, talk about all that.
Then and there's plenty of very specialized parts of the
and the kidneys.
The kidneys. Well, that goes into something else because you see the kidneys is a secondary development. Before that, we have another thing called the mesonephros, which is the preliminary form of mm-hmm. a kidney. And it does mm-hmm. the early forms of waste removal from the blood. Remember, that's what the kidney does.
Right,
that's what the kidney
right.
is for. It's to take waste out of the blood.
It's phenomenal.
And that gets reused, but I won't say what. You can probably fill in the blank.
Yeah, right.
But that gets reused. That part
yeah.
does not get thrown away. It gets uh-huh. built into something else.
And the brain?
And then there's
oh
the brain.
My gosh.
And how the
think
nerves
of the,
are done.
Think
and
of
how
that.
The... And then the absolutely incredible fascination of the eye.
Oh.
And
yeah.
the senses. Thank
yeah.
you.
Yeah.
And the senses,
wow.
but especially the
it's
eye.
So much. And you know what? I kept going through my mind when you were giving this detail. And you haven't even gone into the amount of detail that you could have.
No, there's gobs.
You know what just is so sad when they talk about a pregnancy and then an abortion and say they're getting rid of the products of conception as if they're haphazard blobs of cells, they're getting rid of like it's total waste. And it's this incredible,
yeah.
incredible.
It's the orderliness.
Just
the order is evident from the very beginning. And the fact is that there was one place where I saw noted. Now, I'm not sure because I have certain suspicions about how this mm-hmm. was written, and I won't go into that at length because it gets into what we could call philosophy. But apparently, and this can be known, I think, from the chick, studies of the chicken. Apparently, even at the moment, even at the moment of the very first cell division,
mm-hmm.
there is a polarity to the division.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's fascinating.
And I can't tell you if
yeah.
it's necessarily
that's
going
really
to end up being the up, down, what
yeah.
I said, the three. But there's a apparently there is a polarity.
That's fascinating.
The reason why is the exact sequence that occurs within the fertilization
yeah.
operation itself, because it has to do with the fact that the egg is sort of in suspense.
You're right.
There's
right.
a certain
so,
thing that happens that
yeah,
has to do with
well,
some very intricate questions.
Well,
but I can't go into
now
it.
We are running out of
now
time,
running
Peter.
Out of time.
So I want to be able to say something about your books.
Oh.
Because Peter has some wonderful, wonderful books, which you can get off of Amazon. So if you, Peter Floriani, you can look him up. I've read several of his books and they're just amazing. It's like hearing him speak, he writes the way he speaks, which makes it very easy, I think, to understand. Well, they're very good. So, I'm sure this has perked your interest. If it hasn't, I can't imagine what would, because this is it's just awesome. I mean, to even be able to put this in terms that we can understand when it's such complexity. And you can now you can understand why things go wrong, why there are miscarriages, and why there are, you know, certain birth defects,
when and you're, if because and when you're
there's
pregnant,
a million reactions that go on during that time. It's just amazing.
Yeah, you're very
so. Thanks, Peter.
You're welcome. Anyway,
it was just wonderful and just totally fascinating. I want to make one announcement. I think we had said last month that we were going to do the National Pro-Life Bridge Day on June 26th. On June 20th. And that has been postponed now till July. So I just want to let you know that I think it's July 17th, but we'll announce it again next month. So you know that that's coming up. We also want to remind everyone to please get out and vote tomorrow. That's your duty. That's your ownership of our country. And you have your voice. Use it. So with that, I think we're going to wrap things up. I'm not sure who we're having for our guest next month. We will be having Representative Jerry Knowles, state representative, in July. So that'll be interesting. So we have some other great speakers lined up right through the summer. So we'll be here. We want to thank you for tuning in. And as I said, look for Peter's books on Amazon. You won't be disappointed. And they're also very reasonable. I think you should up his prices, but that's his choice. So with that, we'd like to say good night. And happy Father's Day for June.